So what I'm going to talk about is like when we were talking about classical cryptography a few weeks back, we had a session where we saw how to implement those classical algorithms in Python. So I thought like we should also have a session where we show like how the quantum protocols are implemented, how we can actually simulate them using some of the available programming language. So this one, the example that I'm going to show was actually a part of IBM's Quantum Challenge. So I'm using the same exercise because it has very good explanations. I have edited the notebook a bit, so to match like to make it better. So so I will take you through the PB84 protocol and how to implement it in Qiskit. So before that, I want to talk about something called what Chit was also discussing was it's very fundamental to cryptography, that is the one-time pad. So let me just Can you see the annotation? Okay, so what I'm going to talk about is one-time pad. So what is one-time pad? One-time pad is basically let's say we know that whatever message we are going to send using computers of classical channel or anything, so we will convert our message to bits, right? So we will be basically sending a bit string. So let's say our message M is something like 10011. So this is what we want to send. So basically, let's say we have two people, Alice and Bob. So Alice wants to send the secret message to Bob, right? But this message, let's say, is the location to a treasure which Alice is sending to Bob. And this message goes out, like there are many other people who are looking for this treasure. And if it goes out, they might get to the treasure first, and Alice and Bob have a loss. So this information is very critical right now. So what Alice and Bob did before was in one-time pad was they also had when they were together discussing about that treasure, they created a key. So the key, they said like, let's make the key as 1001. Okay, so let's say that the key is. Let's say the key that they have shared is this. So this key only Alice and Bob know. No other person knows about this key. So what they do in one-time pad is they basically create the encrypted message using the message and key, and they basically do a XOR operation on both of them. XOR is basically addition modulo 2. So basically X plus Y mod 2. So mod 2 because we are talking in bits, we only have 0 and 1. So how does this XOR work is basically if you have 1 and 0, so XOR of 1 and 0 is 1, 0, 1 is 1, 0, 0 is 0, 1, 1 is 1. So, sorry, 0. So using this XOR method, what they will create is the encrypted key, encrypted message. So if we try to add it, so let's say 1 1 is 0 1 1 is 0, 0 0 is again 0 0 1 is 1 and again 0. So what when Alice wants to share this message to Bob, what she will actually send is this encrypted message, right? So just give me a second. Yeah, so let's say our key was okay, sorry for that. Yeah, so let's say our key was something like this, right? 101. Our message was this. Our key was 11011, and our encrypted message was. Is all at 00010. So Alice will send this message to Bob. She will send 01000 to Bob. And let's say if there's Eve, an eavesdropper here, and she can get access to this channel, and she knows, okay, Alice sent 01000 to Bob. She has no way to decode what the actual message was without knowing what the key is. So this key is very important here. So only Alice and Bob know the key. So since Eve does not know the key, she cannot decrypt this message and get any information out of this. But how does Bob get the decrypted message? So Bob can again use the same operation. So he has this key. 110011, and he will again do the same XOR operation. So if we do XOR, 01 is 1 01 is 1, this is 0 and 01 is 1. So if you see, we have again get the same M. So Bob and Alice, if they share a key which they only two of them know, which is private to both of them, they can actually send a message which is foolproof. So it cannot be decrypted. But why do we not use this method always? Like, what is the reason we have all these protocols and algorithms which go into encryption? So because sharing this key is actually the problem. So since in this example, Alice and Bob had met sometime before and they had shared this key. So this key they can use only once. So if they use the same key for another message, Eve can actually use the two messages to make out like what the key was. So that's why this key can be used only once. So that's why it's called a one-time pad. So you can use the key only once. So here the challenge becomes of key distribution. So how to distribute the key? Because if they are distributing the key, if they are sharing their key using some channel like this, like this, the Eve can actually get the key, right? If she has an access to that channel. So they cannot always, whenever they want to send a message, they cannot always meet up and create a key. So in our the age of the internet, like when we are doing our communications, we actually don't go and meet people and create the keys. So the keys have to be shared by the same channels that we are using for our messages. So that's where So basically, the QKD, what the quantum key distribution does is it facilitates this part, the key distribution part. So what it will do is, like, Alice and Bob will use this QKD protocol. Let's say they're using the PB84 protocol. And when they use this protocol, in the end, they will have a key generated for them. So one thing is that, like, even Alice and Bob don't know what key will be generated, what the key will be. So that even if Alice and Bob even don't know what the key will be, it's very difficult for someone else to predict what key will get generated. And this protocol, once Alice and Bob have established a key using the protocol, they can actually go back to one-time pad and encrypt their message using this process. Okay, so that was one-time pad. Let me go back to our BB84 protocol. So what happens in the BB84 protocol is, here we will be using qubits instead of bits, and our information will be encoded in qubits. So so as Archit was talking about the polarizers, the vertical and the horizontal and the diagonal polarizers, so these are basically called bases in quantum terminology. So bases basically mean that that, like, for an example, in coordinate geometry, you would have when we try to show a vector like this, let's say, so it will have some bases. Let's say I and j are unit vectors, and you can represent any vector in this plane in terms of I and j. So let's say alpha I plus beta j, right? Okay, so similarly, you can also represent the same vector in a different basis. So let's say you have another basis like this, which is at an angle theta to the original basis, and let's say we call them delta and delta perpendicular. Okay, so the same thing, we can actually, the same vector we can represent in terms of delta and delta perpendicular like this, comma delta plus something else, delta perpendicular. So the same vector can be represented in different bases, and the number of bases can be actually infinite. So so this is basically what the bases are. So when we talk about bases in quantum computing, in the BB84 protocol, we take two bases. One is the 0-1 basis. Basically, this is 0, this is 1. And the other basis is the plus and minus basis. So the plus and minus basis are basically at an angle of 45 degree to 0 and 1. So this is plus, and this is minus. So plus is basically 1 by root 2, 0 plus 1, and minus is 1 by root 2, 0 minus 1. So we use these four bases. So another concept in quantum computing is called measurement. So measurement is basically projecting your vector to your basis. So what happens in quantum mechanics is, like, let's say you have a vector here. Let's say this is your quantum state. So any quantum state can be represented as a vector. So let's say you have this quantum state psi equals to a0 plus b1. Okay, and you can also write it as alpha plus beta minus. So if you write it in terms of alpha and plus and minus, you have alpha and beta. And if you try to write it in terms of 0 and 1, you have A and B. So what this state tells us is, like, if you measure this state in terms of 0 and 1, so it will collapse to 0 with probability A square, and it will collapse to 1 with probability B square. Right. So when it collapses, it's basically you are taking a projection of the same vector in terms of those bases. Right. So that is how bases work. So if you have this, why do we take these two bases, the plus minus and the 0-1 bases? Is basically because if you have, let's say, if your xi is actually plus and you measure it in the 0 and 1 basis, you getting a 0, you will get 0 with a half probability and 1 with half probability. So since the probability of getting 0 and 1 is both equal, your outcome will be truly random, right? So the measurement of this state will be truly random. So you can actually generate random numbers which are truly random using this measurement. So in the same way, if your xi is let's say 1 or 0, and you're trying to measure it in the plus minus basis, so 0, you can actually write it as 1 by root 2 plus minus. So when you measure 0 in the plus minus basis, it will collapse to plus with our probability and minus with our probability. So basically, if you so that's how the randomness gets encoded in the BBAT4 protocol when we use these two bases, because here the probability of going into the other state and other measuring in another basis is half. So the outcome will be truly random. So you cannot predict like what the outcome will be. So this is totally, we can say this is an unbiased process. Okay, so let's get back to the code part. So let me just quickly talk about what BB84 protocol does. So in the BB84 protocol, what Alice will do is she will have a key string and a basis string. Okay. So in the key string, she will randomly generate some numbers. So let's say, so both will be of n bits, n bit key string and n bit basis string. So she will create a random n bit key string. Let's say something like 100111, and same with the basis. Let's go back to that example only. Okay, so. Okay, so let's say Alice, creates this random string 011001, and she also creates this basis string called 110100. So the key string basically, this string basically, you can say this is the information string and this is the basis string. So what basis string implies is, one means that you are going to measure in the diagonal basis, that is the plus minus basis. And zero means that you are going to encode in the plus 0-1 basis. Okay, so so let's say now what Alice will do is, based upon, so these two are randomly generated. Alice does not have any bias on what the key and B should be, what K and B should be. So she will just create this randomly, both things. So so once she creates this K and B, what she will do is she will prepare qubits. So when you try to encode 0 in the diagonal basis, you will get the plus state. So and so if you go through this example, 0 in the diagonal states become plus, 1 in the diagonal states become minus, 1 in the 0 and 1 basis is 1 because it's in the same basis. 1 in the diagonal is again minus, 0 in the 0, 1 basis is 0, again 0, and again 1. So this part actually should be very clear, because this is the fundamental of this protocol. So here what is basically happening is now let's make it clear that Alice now has prepared some qubits. So these are qubits. So the thing with these qubits is now, because these are qubits and not bits, these are actually quantum systems now. So now the properties of quantum mechanics kick in here, and there are two, there is the no cloning theorem. So if Eve is able to intercept these qubits when she's sending this to Bob, Eve cannot copy this information. Okay, so if she has to get some information out of this, she has to do some operation on it. Eve has to do some operation in this. So the first thing, no cloning theorem ensures that Eve cannot copy these qubits. And the second part is, if Eve wants to do something, she has to do some operation on this. And when she does, it will disturb the system. And this disturbance can be detected by Bob when he is following the protocol. So so let's go down. Okay, so now we have seen what Alice was doing. Now let's get back, let's go to the Bob's part. What is Bob gonna do? So Bob will also do the same thing. But since Alice created K and B randomly, Bob will only do, only create this B string. This is the basic string for Bob. So this will also get generated randomly. And so let's say in this example, Bob creates this 100, 100, 1101. So one means the diagonal basis, and zero means the plus the horizontal and vertical basis. So now what Bob, the next step, what Bob will do is Bob will measure these qubits using the basis he has generated. So when Bob does that, so let's say Bob's this the basis here is the diagonal basis, and the qubit is in the plus state. So when you measure the plus state in the diagonal basis, you will get a plus. And when you and in the same way, when you so here in the next example, the basis is the horizontal and the vertical basis. And when Bob measures minus in this basis, he will in the vertical basis, he can get zero or one with a half probability. So since he is running this only once, now he got zero, but he could have also gotten a one here. So I will say zero and one with half probability. Okay, so let's say in this term, when he's going through this example, his result was zero. Okay, so the next example, next for the next bit, again, you have the one state in the vertical horizontal basis. So you again get one here, minus in the diagonal basis, minus. And here, so same way for the other bits also. So now what happens is, the next step in this in the protocol is, once Bob has measured, he has now created this K tilde. So now these are the Bob's bits. Okay, so these are Bob's bits. So since these bases were also generated in random, we still have made sure that there is no bias towards anything. So now the next step in the protocol is, Alice and Bob will share their basis strings. So B and B dash. So now Alice is not going to share the key part, the key string, basically the bit string. These are private to both of them, but they will only share the B and B dash. So this information even Eve can access. This is public. So next step is, now what they will do is they will match. So for which of these, they will try to match their bases. So let's say, so for example, in these two bit strings, you see that these two are matching, these two don't, these match, these match, these don't, these match, and these don't. So now what they will do is they will just so they will discard these bits. So they will not keep these bits, and they will only use these for indexes. And if you notice, the when their bases are same, the key of Alice and the key string of Bob are also same. So if you see, since here the bases are same, Alice had 0, Bob also got 0. Here Alice had 1, Bob also got 1. So if you look at it, here is 0 and here is also a 0. So these keys of Alice and Bob will automatically match. So, and since they have already, and others they have already discarded, okay? So using, since they automatically match and they have discarded these, they get a key called 0110. So this is called the shifted key. So there are more steps to this protocol, but I will just, to make it simpler, I will just go through this only. So let's say this is the actual key. So in between, if Eve had tried to measure these qubits or do something with it, what will happen is the outcome will change. So if the bases match, the Alice and Bob's bits won't match. This can get detected using another step, by adding another step in the protocol, where what Alice and Bob will do is, instead of creating this as a key, they will share half of the key to each other. So let's say they will share this part to each other and see if there is any discrepancy in these two. They can detect, okay, you did something here, so we will discard this protocol. So that's the basic. So, and then they will keep this key as, this as the key. So so this seems very small, but in actual implementation, this key will be quite long. Let's go to. So this was the example of the whole protocol. Now let's get to the implementation part. So here I'm using Qiskit. I will just take you through the code. So I have two functions here. This is the Alice prepare qubit function. So Alice is, in this example, we are creating a definite, we are not creating Alice's bits randomly right here, but actually we should do that. But what she is doing is, she's for some of the, so here we are dealing with 100 bits of information. So our number of qubits is going to be 100, okay? So we'll, from using these 100 qubits, we will be generating a key in the PB84 protocol. And once the key is generated, Alice and Bob can share a message using the one-time pad. So this example will cover all that. So here what Alice is doing is, she, for each qubit, so here we will be passing this function through a loop, and it will iterate over all the 100 qubits. So for each qubit, what she is doing it, for some of the qubits, she is, so in Qiskit, what happens is, whenever you want to create, you have to create a quantum circuit. So here we are defining a circuit. So this is the initialization part. So QC is our quantum circuit. And whenever you create, so 1,1 means there is one qubit and a classical bit in this register. So this circuit has one qubit and one classical bit. So now what she will do is, basically what we are doing here is, we are flipping some of the, so when this X is the X gate, so X gate, basically what it does is, it flips 0 to 1 and 1 to 0. Okay, so basically that's what it does. So now when we are in here, when we create the circuit, our one qubit is in the zero state by default. So depending upon which iteration it is, we are going to apply an X gate. So if we apply the X gate, that bit will become one. So from zero, it will become one. So if you run this function in inside a loop with 100 iterations, what you will have is 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, then sixth qubit will be one, 11th qubit will be one, 12th qubit will be one, 13th qubit will be one, and rest all of them will be zero. So this is the part where she is creating the K string, and then here she is applying the basis part. So now the QC dot H is basically applying a Hadamard gate to it. So what a Hadamard gate does is it is basically from going from one basis to the other. So the Hadamard gate basically transforms 0 to plus and plus to 0, and it transforms 1 to minus and minus to 1. So you can actually switch back between these two bases using the Hadamard gate. And X gate, as I already told you, it will pick 0 as 1 and 1 as 0. So in the code, what we are doing is now we are preparing the qubits. So once this part is run, what we will have is these prepared qubits in some states, right? So in this example, we will take work in from the point of view of Bob. So let's say we are Bob, okay? And so Alice prepares some qubits. So this is hidden from us. We don't know what this is. This was just for reference. So Alice prepares some qubits. So I will take the code here. So this is the PBQ protocol. So we know that there will be 100 qubits that we will be going to transfer. So Bob, so as I told you, like Bob will create a basis string randomly. So here it creates a binary string, a 100 bit binary string randomly. So here Bob's bases have been created. Now what we will do is number of qubits is 100, right? So for each qubit in the 100 qubit in the 100 bits, we will do is we will get what the we will get. So this function will provide the qubit that Alice has prepared. So this circuit will have Alice's qubit prepared. Then we will apply this Bob measure qubit function. So what this will do is basically, if we already saw that in the basis string, zero means the vertical basis and one means a diagonal basis. So if Bob's basis is zero, we just measured the, so in Qiskit default measurement, is in the horizontal and the 0 and 1 basis basically. So if the basis string of that bit of the basis string is 0, we just directly measure that qubit. And if it is 1, what we will do is we apply that Hadamard gate to switch to the 0 1 basis, and then we measure it. So this is what the Bob measure qubit part will do. So and then what we will do is once this is run 100 times, Bob has measured all the qubits. We will generate the bits. Okay. So this will this part of the code where we are doing the execute. What we are basically doing is we have created this array of all the circuits. So basically 100 circuits are there in this array. And this is the quantum simulator of Qiskit, okay? And we will run it for just one time. So all the results will get stored here, And from again applying a loop through all the qubits, we can actually generate the bits. So let's try to run this code. So basically, this is a BB84 function. So this is used to generate POPs bits. So when we run this, okay. So these are the BOPs basis that basis string. So this is actually the basis the B dash that BOP generated randomly, and these are the bits that he has measured using these bases. So now the next step will be that Alice will now announce her basis bits. So now Alice and Bob are sharing their bases. So Alice's basis for this. So in the next step, what we will do is, so now we need to come. So as I told in the example, we will compare this B and B dash to each other. And this will help us generate the key. So in this code, basically we are going through both Alice and Bob bases and we are comparing it. And we were just appending the key wherever they match. So this part also. So when we run this, we get a key here. Okay. So from 100 qubit protocol, we get. So I think this is 50 bits long. So we get this key generated. Now what Alice will do? So fundamentally, Alice and Bob now are sharing this. So this has this gets generated for both Alice and Bob. So trusting this protocol, they know that this is the secure key, and it will be same for both Alice and Bob. So now what Alice will do is Alice now will use the bomb.